Good evening again, everyone. Apologies for our late start, but as you know, sometimes technology has a mind of its own. But we are ready and raring to go as we continue to delve into the seven sacred spaces. As you know, we would have started our Lenten journey as we looked at the seven sacred spaces as examined in the book written by George Links. Now, if you don't have a copy of this book, I'm sure as you would have experienced over the last 2 weeks, you can still participate meaningfully in this conversation as we look together at areas in which we can build our spiritual life and the spiritual tools that we can add to our spiritual toolbox to help us grow a deeper faith as Christians. In week one, we would have looked at the idea and the concept of cloister, where we were looking at relationships and encounters and meetings along the various pathways of our spiritual life. And we recognize that some of these encounters can be planned and they can be unplanned, and they can teach us a little bit more about who we are as Christians. They can challenge us, and they can even draw us closer to God. They can cause us as well to reflect on our own attitudes and behaviors, and to examine whether or not they resemble where God would have us go. Last week, we looked at two sacred spaces. We considered chapel and we considered scriptorium. And looking at the chapel, we recognized that we were talking about public worship and that public worship has its place. But also, we need to go beyond public worship in developing our spiritual connection with God and with each other. We looked at scriptorium, recognizing that study is important as we seek to grow. And study can take many forms, whether it be in Bible study, whether even within the chapel setting, we can have moments of study and learning and growth. And indeed, these deeper life encounters are a period for us to enter into study as we learn more together. This week, we are going to be looking at the idea, the concept of cell. And this particular concept is one that the writer George Links probably spends the most of his time talking about. It's the longest chapter in his book, The Seven Sacred Spaces. And we're going to be delving into the question of what alone time with God looks like and time alone with God in prayer. This evening, we are going to have Reverend Darryl Barrow, who will share with us. He is a Methodist from the MCCA, and you're going to hear a little bit more about him. He also hails from the South Caribbean, and we're going to talk to him a little bit more and find out exactly what his thoughts are on cell. But as we prepare ourselves to think more about our topic this evening, let me invite Reverend Joran Fils to lead us in our devotions, after which we're going to have our host, Kelvin Allen, who's going to introduce our speaker this evening, and then we'll get into the meat of the matter. So we start first with Reverend Fils as he leads us in our devotions. And of course, let me welcome each and every one of you to this session this evening. Yeah, we're starting a little late, and so we probably skipped a little bit on the welcome, but I just want to ensure that everyone feels welcome in this space. And to know that as we worship together in the devotions, as we study together in devotions, as we engage in the topic that we shall discuss this evening, that all are welcome to share as they are guided. So, Reverend Fils, over to you.
Thank you, Brother Tech. And I greet you, brothers and sisters, in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As we share in this devotion tonight, we begin our devotion by listening to, singing along with the song By the Power of Your Love.
Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love.
Father, as we gather tonight, we gather, oh God, because of your love towards us. We are able, oh God, to gather and fellowship and share like this only because of your loving kindness towards us. And as your word reminds us that you love this world so much that you gave your only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. You demonstrated your love for us, that even while we were yet sinners, while we were ungodly, while we did not want, we were not studying you and did not want to have much to do with you. Jesus Christ died for us. And not only did Jesus die for us, but because of his death, we today can be recipients of forgiveness. We today can be the recipients of the gift of your Holy Spirit. And your word tells us that by your Spirit, you have poured your love into our hearts. And so, God, we praise you. We bless your name tonight. And so, God, as we share in your word, we ask for your guidance and your wisdom. Oh God, we confess that many times we have not lived in that love that you have given to us and continue to bless us with. So God, you are a pardoning God, and it is because of you who you are why we continue to press on in our relationship with you. So bless us, oh God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Tonight I would like to read from Ephesians chapter 3, from verses 14 to 19. Says, "For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, that he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with the power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." My brothers and sisters, as we share tonight, as we continue in our deeper life encounters, the word deeper life, it's a word that is used regularly in the church and for different events and activities. And the understanding is that when we gather for any deeper life meeting, encounter, that we are seeking to be deepened in our walk or relationship with God. So deeper life is coming into greater understanding that life is more than what we can see. It is getting to the real substance of life. It is coming into fuller understanding about our purpose for existence and living in that purpose. So when life starts having more purpose and meaning and fulfillment and peace and joy, we are more and more entering into deeper life. But in the according Christianity, the key to such obtaining a deeper life is found only in a growing relationship with God, getting closer to God. John 17:3 tells us that this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. So there is no deeper life apart from a relationship with God. And the key to in Christianity to having that deeper relationship and getting deeper with God is found only in the person of Jesus Christ. It is that where we surrender life as we knew it, totally and fully commit our lives to following and walking with Jesus. And in this devotion, it is what I will be focusing on is that deeper life is to come into greater knowledge of the love of Christ that produces deeper life. As Christ says, "I came that you may have life and have it abundantly." One of the reasons why the Apostle Paul wrote to the Ephesians was that although they were believers, they were very much unaware of how rich they were in Christ. And as a result, even though they were Christians and they were rich in Christ, they were living as paupers. So Paul writes to remind them of the riches that they have in Christ so that they can begin to use this wealth that they have. And so the passage that was read is the second of two prayers in the book. And Paul is praying at the end of this chapter for the believers. And he's praying that they will be able, being enabled to start tapping into and laying hold of this wealth and the riches that are found in the love of Christ. And so here just a few verses again, he says, "For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you have been rooted and grounded in love." You see, his prayer had several requests, and he was requesting for strengthening, deepening, for greater comprehension and fullness in the love of Christ. And so by strengthening, Paul, in verse 16, Paul was saying, suggesting that deeper life, or to go deeper in the love of Christ, is produced firstly by internal strengthening, greater reliance on the power of the Holy Spirit. So what I gather from this is that there can be no deeper life in our own strength. Deeper life comes as we are able to yield to the Holy Spirit more. That's why I believe he adopts the posture of "I bow my knees before the Father." Tells of humbling our hearts and wills. And then he says in verse 17, not only about strengthening, but he talks about deepening our depth. Because he says in verse 17, "And that in Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love." And that word "dwell" speaks of settling down and feeling at home. So he was praying for the believers that Christ may be able to settle down and feel at home in their hearts as they become more and more and one with Christ. And so it's as if the more that their will and their heart and what they want line up with what God wants, is the more that Christ is able to dwell, to feel at home, that there's less wrestling. And I believe I heard, you know, remember this, the hymn that says, "Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed." So when we stop, you know, more and more we stop fluctuating between the world and the circumstances of life and Christ, we are able to less and less stifle the deeper life that God wants us to have. But he also speaks about rooted and grounded. And if you think about rooted, that's farm language, that's think of a tree or a plant. And the roots, in order for the tree to be able to grow as it ought, it has to grow deep roots in the soil for nutrients, for nourishment and stability. So deeper life requires for our roots to go deeper and deeper in the love of Christ. In other words, the fruit of love can only come forth in the Christian life if we are growing roots. If we are positioning ourselves to hear from God's word, if we are watering our roots, with watering it with the prayer and with faith sharing and with worship and with fellowship, and getting rid of the weeds that may come around our roots, the cares of the world, the sinful habits, and worrying over the circumstances of life. And then we are able to have deeper and deeper roots in the love of Christ. And he says grounded. And grounded speaks about building language, the foundation on which we build. Persons in construction would say that if you don't go deep with your foundation, you can't go high in building. The most important part of a building is the foundation. So deeper life challenges us to ensure that our foundation is found on nothing but the love of Christ, nothing but the blood of Christ. Grace and mercy of God that is found through Jesus Christ. That's why the songwriter puts it on Christ, the solid rock we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. And so as I close, I believe this is why Paul goes on to pray and say, "I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses all knowledge. So it is as we are able to have deep roots and to have the right foundation. Paul is saying his prayer is that as they have this foundation, that they are able to experience the love of Christ in all its dimensions, to go deeper. And so to talk about breath, could be speaking about that the love of Christ, which covers all sins and covers all circumstances of life. The length, in talking about the everlasting love, God loves us from eternity to eternity. The height, that the love of Christ can take us to unimaginable heights that we could never even dream of. And the depth, talking about Calvary's cross and that it reaches to all people. And I believe this is why he ends with this benediction. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let us just go to God in prayer. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your love. And, oh God, we thank you that as we journey with you and as we build our relationship with you, God, we know that it is your desire for us to go deeper, deeper and deeper in the love of Jesus. And so, God, enable us, strengthen us, help us to grow deep roots, help us, oh God, to have the right foundation so that, oh God, we can indeed know your love in all its dimensions. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I now hand back over to Brother Craig.
Thank you very much, Reverend Fils. Let me invite our hosts for this evening, Brother Kelvin Aline, to take the lead and to introduce our speaker this evening, as well as to moderate the next section of this evening's teaching session. Brother Kelvin.
Hi, good evening, everybody. And good evening to those who would have tarried with us, as we did have a slightly late start. But we appreciate you staying. My job this evening is to be your host, and I have with me an introduction of Reverend Darryl Barrow, and I would like to tell you a bit more about him. So Reverend Darryl Barrow is currently the lead pastor at Lockport Emmanuel United Methodist Church in Upper New York Conference. And over his 35 years of ministry, he has served as a university chaplain at Emory University in Atlanta, a conference program director in Upper and the District Superintendent of Crossroads District, Syracuse, New York, in the Upper New York Conference of the United Methodist Church. And he has been a supervising 65 pastors in 78 churches. Reverend Barrow is Trinidadian by birth, and he was formally ordained as a presbyter of the Methodist Church in the Caribbean and the Americas, and served in several churches in the Caribbean. He graduated with a bachelor's degree, first class honors in arts and general studies, with a theology option from the University of the West Indies, Mona Campus, and he went on to receive his theological and pastoral formation at the United Theological College of the West Indies with a diploma in ministerial studies. And he would receive as well there the Academic Excellence Award. He since then also pursued a Master of Theology degree at the Columbia Theological Seminary, Decatur in Georgia, and in the area of religion, culture, and society. He is an accomplished percussionist. He plays the congas, as well as djembe drums and handheld percussions in both African and Afro-Caribbean rhythms. He has found music and social outreach to be great ways of bringing persons together, and especially through drumming circles. So to bring awareness to social justice issues and also to embrace diversity with people on the margins. He enjoys advising youth, young adults, and adults in service and leadership projects in both local and overseas contexts. Reverend Barrow has two sons, Darryl Jr., who is a paper engineer and lives with his wife, Shalini, in Fort Edwards, New York, and Dwayne, who has completed his schooling as of last December, 2023, and he is now working as of January as a process system engineer in Buffalo, New York. Reverend Barrow has professed a love for various sports and also enjoys the outdoors, of which I am sure then one of those things would be cricket. So I would like to introduce Reverend Barrow, who will be presenting to us this evening on CELL, being alone with God in personal prayer. And afterwards, we would, of course, want to engage with him, maybe on some of these areas as he enlightens us and brings us to thought on this area. I invite you to bring your camera online, Reverend Barrow, and to join us. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening to my South Caribbean district sisters and brothers. My family is how I see the South Caribbean district. I want to thank all of you who have helped to make this Deep Life encounter one of impactfulness, of encounter in a way that has brought growth, spiritual growth to your lives, and one in which you have been journeying in a very important subject matter. I want to thank also our presenter for the centering time that has given me my own sense of calmness as I listen to the presentation. It is my pleasure and always a great joy to join my sisters and brothers in the South Caribbean district. I am a son of the soil, as you've heard, and I have stayed connected to the ministries and missions of the district. I have great admiration and great respect for the Reverend Derek Richards, your district bishop. And I pray daily for God's hand to be upon his pastoral leadership, both in his circuit work and especially in his district work, and of course for his family. So once again, I thank you for this invitation. I want you to know that even though I work now as a pastor in the UMC, I am always ready and willing to support the work in South Caribbean District and will do anything that is possible to be of assistance to the district. Thanks again for giving me this opportunity to share in this deeper life encounter during this season of Lent. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks. And in the stillness of the evening, we hear your voice. In the stillness, and we pray, Lord, that you will allow my words to be your words of truth and compassion, of hope and encouragement. Bless this time, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. I am going to deal this evening with the sacred space of CELL, being alone with God in personal prayer. And I would add to that in the shaping of a more effective church and engagement in the mission. CELL, being alone with God in personal prayer. Today we find ourselves 5 days removed from 4 years ago when the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a worldwide pandemic. And the world seemingly came to a sudden, surreal halt. The hustle and the bustle and the unbearable noise we deal with on a daily basis and the almost nonstop way we live our daily lives suddenly came to a halt. Do you remember what you were doing on March 11, 2020, when the announcement came to us? COVID-19 has presented the church an opportunity once again to discern together fruitful ways forward to shape a more effective church and engagement in mission. The church urgently needs fresh expressions and a fresh reflection, may I say, deeper life encounters on the different ways in which we are the body of Christ. Canon George Lings, writing in his book during the critical period of COVID-19, which we are all now learning to live with, Lings offers in abundance different ways, ingredients, one might say, of sacred spaces in his seven sacred spaces. Canon Lings distills new wisdom for today and from scripture and from the monastic tradition. Reverend Dr. Stephen Croft, Bishop of Oxford, says every local church will find in seven sacred spaces a rich inspiration and strong practical support. And I would add, for our individual faith journey and for our collective work in the church for the shaping of more life-giving and fruitful mission. You know, we often think that monastic spaces and monastic practices and the monastic life are only for monks, only for those who have a special calling to live a life that is set aside from the world. So often the majority of Christians might wait only for the season of Lent, or only for a season of revival services in our churches to intentionally live out their faith in the practices of intentional prayer and fasting and silence and being alone with God. But in seven sacred spaces, we are presented with the challenging proposal that the rhythm of monastic life does not need to be confined to the monastery. Rather, it can shape and enrich the lives of men and women of all ages and in all states of life, says Sister Frances Dominica. Indeed, this evening, I would submit to you, as pointed out by Chris Russell, vicar and advisor to Archbishop Canterbury, that these seven sacred spaces are a way of living that makes possible what many of us truly long for, an authentic Jesus-shaped life, an authentic Jesus-shaped life. We long for that. One of those Jesus-shaped life patterns are found in cell, being alone with God in prayer, one of the sacred spaces of the monastic life. And what I'm assigned to share with you this evening. Now, friends, George Lings infers that when we hear of cell, it does not mean a locked small room in a prison, even though those two can be a place of reflection and realization. Now, I'm not suggesting that you need to be in prison in order to experience this reflection and realization, but he's not referring to the prison cell. But it got me thinking of my first of a few visits to South Africa And specifically, when I visited Robben Island, viewing the very small cell that Nelson Mandela was forced to call home for 27 years, his tall frame could barely stretch out in his cell, was a stark reminder, and at the same time, an inspiration that some of his best writings on a nonviolence approach to a free South Africa came out of that cell. Now, monastic cells, however, are entered voluntarily. They're not entered by force, and you hold the keys. You are both accountable. You make the first step. Your spiritual development depends on making that first step. You hold the keys. No cell, says Links, about the small building blocks in the biology of living things. Although the issue of what makes for life does occur in both. Cell is the smallest place of the seven sacred spaces, says Links. And even though it's the smallest place, as was shared with us earlier, George Links has given most of his time to this smallest place in the seven sacred spaces. In his book, Links says that by cell, I mean the small space, wherever it is, in which a person meets privately with God and thereby meets their inner self. That is the priority of spending quality time alone with God. Cell life with God, the simple, quiet time with God. Tonight, I want you to think of where your cell is. Where do you meet privately with God in prayer? In holy, life-giving conversations with God. Where is that place for you, friends? When you think about what's really important, what you would do if you knew you didn't have a lot of time left, what would you do? What would you do if you knew you didn't have a lot of time left? Well, you'll cut to the heart of this sacred space called cell, wouldn't you? You'll turn off your cell phone, wouldn't you? You'll turn off your cell phone and stop checking your email for a few hours. You'll probably go for a walk in the park, in the sun, or in the rain, or in the cool of the evening, and use your five senses, six senses, I don't know, to see and smell and feel and taste and hear and perceive the natural world around us. You let the dishes soak in the sink. You let the dishes soak in the sink for an evening, wouldn't you? And snuggle up in your cell. That is the quiet place in your home or wherever it is. You'll probably sit in the dark on your porch, if you have a porch, marveling at the Big Dipper or the Little Dipper. I don't care. Friends, so much of the time we surround ourselves with is what I call white noise. We surround ourselves with white noise, the combination of all the different frequencies of sound around us. But God wants to talk with us amidst the noise and the distractions. God wants to linger with us, but we have to make a quiet space for God to come in. That's the cell that Lings is talking about here, the quiet space for God to come in. A truly simple cell life is making that room, cutting out the things that clamor our attention, if only for a little while. It means taking small steps. Perhaps journaling for 15 minutes a day in that space, trusting that what's most important will float to the surface. I think leaders in particular, we ought to spend time journaling and not rushing the process of what God is asking us to do next. Letting prayer bookend your days. You see, life can be complicated, and giving some of that complication to the Lord moves us a step closer toward embracing that sacred space. We think, we journal, and we muse, and we ask ourselves, do I need the latest and the fastest and the best things in my life? Do I need to shave every single day and pick out all the gray hair that shaving doesn't catch? Is a 15-step makeup application necessary every morning? Or will a little bit of mascara and lip gloss accomplish the same thing? No, seriously. Do I feel proud telling others how over schedule I am, affirming my worth? Or do I take pride in complaining how exhausting your volunteer work is? Do we need the badge or the brooch of a complicated life to convince others and ourselves of our value? Jesus says, we don't need a whole lot of extra equipment. We don't need a whole lot of extra equipment in St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 6 and verse 8. Living the truly simple cell life means giving up some of our ideals about how we want others to view us. In other words, this sacred space of cell begins by eroding our pride while teaching us humility. So let's turn now to the biblical narrative here, the biblical narrative in George Ling's Seven Sacred Space, and particularly his space on cell. Canon Ling's reminds us that we are not going to find the word cell in the Bible. In the same way, we are not going to find the word Trinity in the Bible, or Christmas or Easter in the Bible. However, one biblical root is in Jesus' command in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. I want you to notice that Jesus doesn't use the subjunctive tense or mood in this text. He doesn't say, if we pray. Rather, he used the indicative mood. It is a given that we will pray. When you pray, go into your room and close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. Ling says that this teaching from the Sermon on the Mount is strengthened by Jesus's own life of taking time with God. Most importantly, he notes that oftentimes before Jesus made big decisions, before Jesus had big encounters, Jesus took time with God. Jesus put the cell life at the center of his life, of his teachings, of his ministry, of his miracles. He put the cell life of taking time with God at the center. Listen to the biblical narratives of Jesus's alone time with God in prayer. Perhaps you are familiar with some of them. St. Matthew chapter 14 and verse 23. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. Cell. St. Mark chapter 1 and verse 35. And rising early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place, and there he prayed. Cell. St. Luke chapter 5, verse 16. But he would withdraw to desolate places to pray. Cell. Luke 6, chapter 12. In these days, he went out to the mountain to pray. And all night he continued to pray to God. Cell. St. Mark 6, verse 31. And he said to them, come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while. For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. Cell. Examples after examples of Jesus's putting at the center of his life this alone time with God. And there are also references in the Old Testament and in the epistles of prophets and priests and apostles spending alone time with God in prayer. Now, my friends, it is important to note that the seven sacred spaces are very much interrelated. In other words, they overlap, says Lings. One is not more important than the other. Spending alone time with God does not exclude from chapel, corporate, public worship. It doesn't exclude from that. But it doesn't mean that you might get so busy. What we call church busyness. You know what church busyness is? We get so busy. Sometimes when we're in worship, I know people when they're in worship, they're thinking about their Sunday dinner and what they have to go home to prepare and cook. Church busyness means other things too. It means those meetings after meetings that you neglect the time to be alone with God. In fact, friends, I would submit to you that time alone with God fuels your passion and your purpose for corporate worship and for refectory and for fellowship and for cloister or well-planned meetings. It fuels that alone time with God fuels that. But we Methodists, and look, this is not just Methodists in the Caribbean. This is Methodists in the United States and Methodists in England and Methodists in Africa. Methodists are notorious for getting bogged down with meetings and calling meetings to plan a meeting. And then that meeting requires another meeting. And you get the point? We become so exhausted and so burned out, pastors and lay leaders and members, we have no time for self, to spend time alone with God before the next meeting. But why? Why is cell different to all the other six spaces? Well, Lings says, and I quote, "There is something fundamentally valuable about being alone. Being alone is often confused," he says, "with concepts of loneliness and being an individual." And he says those last two connect, right? Here they connect. Loneliness might be called the unwelcome absence of others, whereas being alone can be the pleasure and the adventure of solitude, says Ling. Let me say that again. Loneliness might be called the unwelcome absence of others, whereas being alone can be the pleasure and adventure of solitude, says Ling. Friends, we do live in a noise-polluted, hectic, tiresome culture. People are just tired. COVID-19 reminded us of how tired we were, we really were, and how tired we are. And the stillness and the quietness became dreadful. And many were terrorized by the fear of loneliness. You know, friends, sometimes we just need to slow down and to discern what really are the main things to enhance and grow our ministries as a church. We need to slow down and discern what are the main things to enhance and grow our ministries as a church. But silence and solitude allows for leaders, pastors, and people to discern and to vision more effectively the main things that can lead to the shaping of a more effective church and engagement in the mission, to be a more caring and sharing and loving church, requires each of us individually, beginning with pastors, but with lay leaders and with all followers of Christ, the space, the cell for silence and solitude and alone time with God. So here is my postscript for this sacred space we call cell. Blaise Pascal, 17th century French writer, said all of humanity's problems stem from our inability to sit quietly in a room alone. All of humanity's problems stem from our inability to sit quietly in a room alone. That's true. It's a sweeping claim, but it might just be the kind of overstatement we need today to be awakened from our relentless stream of distractions and diversions. How hauntingly true it might be that we are unable to sit quietly. 400 years after Pascal, life may be as hurried and anxious as it has ever been. The competition for our attention is ruthless. We not only hear one distracting siren call after another, but an endless cacophony of voices bombards us all at once. And yet, long before Paschal, as I've pointed out to you earlier, Jesus himself modeled for us the very kind of habits and rhythms of life we need in any age. Even as God in human flesh, he prioritized, he put first time alone with God, time alone with his Father. Imagine what good he might otherwise have done with all the hours he had. But he chose again and again, in perfect wisdom and love, to give his first and best moments to seeking his Father's face. And if Jesus, even Jesus, carved out such space in the demands of his human life, shouldn't we all the more? We may have but glimpses of Jesus's habits and personal spiritual practices in the Gospels, especially that of cell. But what we do have is by no accident, and it is not scant. We know exactly what God means for us to know in just the right detail. And we have far more about Jesus's personal rhythms than we do about anyone else in Scripture. And the picture we have of Christ's habits is not one that is foreign to our world and our lives and our experiences. Rather, we find timeless and transcultural postures that can be replicated and easily applied by any follower of Jesus anywhere in the world at any time in history. For 2,000 plus years, the teachings of Christ have called us as his people into rhythms of retreating from the world and entering into the world. The healthy Christian life is neither wholly solitary or wholly communal. We withdraw, like Jesus, to a desolate place and to commune with God, and we return to the bustle of daily tasks and the needs of others. We carve out a season for spiritual respite in some momentarily sacred space to feed our souls, enjoying God there in the stillness. Then we enter back as light and bread to a hungry, harassed, and helpless world. Before rehearsing Jesus's patterns in retreating for prayer and then re-entering for ministry, we should observe the place of Scripture in his life. Jesus did not have his own personal material copy of the Bible. Like all of us today, he heard what was read aloud in the synagogue. He heard it orally. And what his mother sang, and he rehearsed what he had put to memory. And yet throughout his recorded ministry, we see evidence of a man utterly captivated by what is written in the text of Scripture. You know, friends, this season of Lent, I am reading a chapter a day of St. John's Gospel. In fact, I'm reading it with a close personal friend of mine. And we get to share, it's like our own cell about the St. John's Gospel, a chapter a day. We also do a devotional time from the United Methodist Disciplines Devotional. Those have been some of the best times for me in my spiritual journey. And I plan to do this beyond Lent, first in the Gospels and then the Acts of the Apostles, then to the pastoral epistles and so forth. Even though Jesus didn't have his own Bible to page through his quiet times, let there be no confusion about the central place of God's written word in his life. What an amazing opportunity we now have, friends, of the Old and New Testaments in paper and ink. Everywhere we go, even on our phones, to daily give ourselves to God's word, pastors, leaders, members alike, the same patterns he had with praying and fasting and teaching. I encourage you to follow as closely as you can, friends, the Wesley pattern of fasting. Fridays, Wesley fasted on a Friday. Fridays after breakfast, or you might skip breakfast, and Wesley ended his fast at 3 p.m. In it all, in receiving his father's voice in scripture and praying alone and with company. In fact, you could have a companion, a partner in your cell. At times when he faced particularly pressing concerns, adding the tool of fasting, Jesus sought communion with his father. His habits were not demonstrations of will and sheer discipline. His acts of receiving the word and responding in prayer were not ends in themselves. In these blessed means, he pursued the end of knowing and enjoying his Father, and so do we today. We don't retreat from life's busyness and bustle as an end in itself, to sit quietly in a room alone, in Pascal's words. That's not an achievement, but that's an instrument. To sit quietly in a room alone is an instrument, an opportunity to open up our lives and our souls to God, for whom we were made, and to know God, and to soak in God, and to enjoy God. Thank you once again for the opportunity to share with you.
Thank you as well, Reverend Barrow. Really appreciate your presentation. What I'm going to do now, I will ask us just kind of enter a period of just contemplation briefly. There was something that Reverend Barrow had recommended we wanted to do at the beginning of his talk. So I did remember during the talk. So I'll ask that we actually spend a moment of contemplation as we take in this song, and then we'll open the floor for questions.
Come and find the quiet center in the crowded life we lead. Find the room for hope to enter. Find the frame where we are free. Clear the chaos and the clutter. Clear our eyes that we can see all the things. Thank you.
must travel open to each other's pain. Let our loves and fears unravel, celebrate the space we gain. There's a place for deepest dreaming, there's a time for heart to care. In the spirit's lively scheming, there is always room to spare.
Hey, I'm back. That's one of the problems if you're using two devices. Okay, so having listened to that that song I did earlier today, and I was drawn to mind about two things based off of what you were presenting, Reverend Barrow. One thing that jumped out to me for sure is that the concept of the cell is essentially the only place where we're alone. Yes. In comparison to the other areas.
Correct.
Right? And yes. And that was probably the biggest thing that I noticed, having taken a look at the book as well. It's an actually very interesting book, and it's one that I'm probably going to have to get for myself, having done some precursory reading through it online. One other thing that jumped out at me was during the pandemic, I would just ask persons to think just a little bit, especially for those of us in the Caribbean, we did have some serious periods of lockdown. If you could just think for just a few seconds as to what were you doing in that first couple of weeks when the lockdown was called, and when, you know, what was that like for you? I remember the first church service after the lockdown was called, which I think was the weekend of March 19th. I remember only 20, actually it was the 22nd. It was my wife's birthday. If I remember correctly, it was actually the 22nd. So it would have been that weekend. And if you just think for a moment, I'll give you a sec just to think, what was it you were doing in those first couple of weeks? Now, I would ask, you know, I guess probably maybe the first question in terms of the contemplation, the period of contemplation, that time of being alone with God, there's a concept of the altar in terms of a personal altar in your home. There is also the concept of a thin place. This is actually something I ran into before. In looking at the book, I'd actually heard about the Celtic worship understanding, yeah, and how they understood their Christian faith, and they had the concept of a thin place, an area where you felt closest to God. Yeah. So if you could maybe mention to us, you know, the similarities around those things, because one of the areas that persons may have struggled with initially with this text would have been, as you said, the monastic themes and kind of bringing them home to our current lives. So if you could maybe just speak a little bit about that and what we could maybe kind of think to declutter things for us in that area.
Yes. Well, that's really a good question. And I think I have to imagine that in the Celtic culture, because of the climate of the day, there's ample time for that thin space, as you reference it there. I just think that folks, on the one hand, we have a period of time when folks did not have all the gadgets and all of the instruments at their disposal. And I don't want to be unfair to say, in Celtic culture, dating back to the 17th century, 16th century, where there seemed to be room for that, even in some cases, tarrying in darkness. I'm not sure if I'm calling for that today, but I'm certainly calling for folks to slow down. I'm calling for folks in the church. I'm calling for pastors and for members, for leaders, to not try to do God's work without giving God the space. And that space is both, you need to take individual space, as I think, you know, was always a practice both in monastic life. I think we tend to feel that things must happen today. It must happen quickly. And that's something I think we need to be, for our own individual growth, we need to be able to give some time to allow God to for us to soak in God, to linger with God. I think that is a practice that could only come. And look, we in the Caribbean, we have the places to do that. We have mountains, we have the beach, we have quiet spaces, not just within the home, but outside of the home. But I think a good place to start is within the home, to create a thin space, a dark space, and a clear private space to begin that journey, that discipline, I would say, that discipline of talking with God, of conversation with God, of scripture being at the center of that conversation with God. I believe we have to get back to that, because what we've done is we've allowed COVID to get us back to a pace, a pre-COVID pace that I don't think is good for the church. And the church might just need to slow just a bit to be listening to the culture. We have to find time now to figure out where people are. And I think that's the difference I see in both the Celtic tradition and in the monastic tradition. I think the idea of listening, not just to God, but listening to others, played an important role. And I think sometimes the church, we are busy doing what we think the world needs or people need. And we often forget we need to listen. So I don't know if I've answered that completely, but I know as I think of where he was going with Celtic life and monastic life and how it will relate today, I would conclude by saying we need to be living both of our professional life, our family life, and our church life at a slower pace that invites listening.
Thank you. I would agree wholeheartedly. So what I'm going to do now is just a little housekeeping, just some reminders. We can use the chat feature in Zoom to get your questions in. Please feel free to use the raise hand as well. Even if you get it wrong, you get the thumbs up, that'll work as well, no problem. And we'll get you going. So I've started you off, and I would love to see if any persons have any thoughts, any questions for Reverend Barrow, who has given us a bit to think about, and where we may want to maybe think about how we practice our disciplines in our faith.
And especially what we were doing in COVID time and what we're doing now. What are we doing differently now from COVID time and what we're doing now in terms of what spiritual practices, spiritual disciplines have come to the surface, have floated up for us?
Okay. Thank you. I see Sister Jean, if you would come in.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Jeanne Beckles. And good evening, Reverend Jean. Barrow.
Hello.
Blessings. Hello. Yes, long time no see in here. I'm wanting, thank you very much for your presentation and especially what you have brought in with regard to COVID and how we should probably have entered back in a little more slowly, a little more deliberately, taking the good that came from the times of reflection during that period. I wanted to ask your advice or your comment. I went on a retreat once because God told me I needed to spend some time with him. And it was phenomenal. It was a silent retreat, so it was just me and the Lord. I didn't talk to anybody else while I was there. And while there, it was at Codrington College. And one of the seminarians was assigned to say a mass for me for my birthday. And I said to him that I found the busyness of my life so much that, you know, I had to get away. And he said to me, you have to learn how to find what you describe as self. You have to find a way of creating that within your busyness. You know, you have to, in the midst of the busyness, not just retreat away, but have a way in which you separate yourself off with God. What is your advice or your opinion on that?
I affirm that. In fact, sometimes when I find some of the quietest time for me is when I pause at work, when I'm on my way to see someone, especially going to the hospital, I find that those moments of pausing, of allowing real pause, I'm talking about here, Jean, I'm talking about the real pause of, because I don't think we could get rid of, you know, what we do and who we are, but I think what we can do, and I like how that's the creative way I would look for. I would look for the way in which, whether it is the break at lunch, to set aside 15 minutes or 5 minutes or 10 minutes of that break during lunch, or even it might just be that, you know, every couple of hours, you are intentional. This is an intentional thing you are doing. So it doesn't have to be the first thing in the morning. It doesn't have to be the last thing at night. It is a continuum, right? A continuous process throughout the day to find small moments to develop self. So I think for busy people, and I know you are perhaps very busy, I like that approach of finding sell in the busyness. Am I answering your question? I think I would
yes,
say
I understand what you're saying, and maybe truly setting, as you say, every hour, every 2 hours, turning away from the busyness and the world, and turning to God in the midst. Because if we're supposed to be praying without ceasing, if we're supposed to be as Brother Lawrence said, practicing the presence of God. God is there. He's right there with you. But it is for you to refocus. It's for you to realize, okay, no, Lord, I can spend this time, and intentionally make that time maybe more as we go along.
I think we make time for a lot of things. And if we could make time, you know, anyone who has a to-do list or use their calendar on their phone, we make time for that. We can make time for space.
For God. Awesome. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan.
Thank you,
Sister Jan. I am going to go in the order that I've seen. I'll invite Sister Pearl Maureen, if you could unmute and come in.
Yes. Reverend Barrow, good evening.
Thank you, Pearl.
Yes, it is. Yes. You know, what I'm thinking is that before COVID, we were rushing. Mm-hmm. And then we sort of slowed down after, you know, while COVID was on. And now we're back, you know, and we have the tendency to rush again.
Yes.
But what we need to remember at all times, that time is not ours. Time is not ours. Tomorrow isn't promised to anyone. As a matter of fact, the next hour isn't, the next minute isn't promised to you. Time is God's time. And if we recognize that, we will just slow down. Because, you know, what happens sometimes, you have to go somewhere. And you have to be, you know, you're rushing and like things are not going good. And you're waiting on some, you know, maybe somebody to take you there. And the person is late and you're, oh. And you know, when you realize The person came late, but the person came late as far as you are concerned. But you say, but wait a minute, you know, it's a good thing I didn't come earlier. It is a good thing. So we have to recognize that the time is not ours. Just right. Let God, you know, rule. Let God control our lives and whatever it is not ours to do. It is not ours to control. Time is not ours.
Yeah.
Okay? So that's my contribution.
Yeah. And I couldn't say it better. Thank you, Auntie Pearl.
Welcome.
Thank you, Sister Pearl. I do have one item in the chat, and then we're going to come to Brother Nurse, Lawrence Nurse. So in the chat, I have here from Sister Headley, Heather Headley. She's greeted us and she's asked the question, two questions. Is the time of day important for that quiet time with God, or do we engage with God every moment of our active lives? And the follow-up would be, do we seek a peace which surpasses all understanding as we fast as well? So two pretty big questions there, actually.
Yeah, those are good questions. And I think the question might be getting at is if we stay in a constant posture of allowing God and our seeking God and our searching God to be constant, I think that is something that comes with spiritual growth. But I think that having intentional time, the intentional discipline of setting aside time, and I try not to sort of get into saying to folks, it must be the first thing in the morning and the last thing at night. But all I know is that it has to be intentional. I also think that, I don't know if the question was linked to fasting and a peace that surpasses all understanding. I know what I can do is I could offer you what the Wesley pattern was and what I think Wesley drew from the pattern of Christ. And it is that when you are fasting, I think you seek God's peace through scripture. I don't think you're fasting like if you're trying to fast for a diet. You know, people use fasting purely for dieting. But I think the fast is a place of deep hunger for God. And in that hunger for God, in that deep search, in that deep life encounter with God, I believe that peace that surpasses human understanding becomes part of that whole process. So for example, when I find when I am done with some reading and some praying. And sometimes when I pray with a companion, I am just left in total stillness, in total silence. And I can't even sometimes understand what brought on the silence. And I think that's the peace that that is beyond my understanding. So I think fasting and peace go hand in hand if in those moments of fasting, you are in the moments of fasting, not every single moment, but in various times in the fast, having a hunger for God in scripture. And I don't believe it has to be just scripture. I think some devotional material have a sense of bringing things out to us, and even some books on life teachings. Sometimes I tend not to just simply say, read the scripture. There are a variety of ways God speaks to us, and we just have to be open to that. I think we have to have an open mind, and we have to be intentional.
Thank you. And thank you for that question, Sister Heather. I'm going to invite Brother Lawrence Nurse, if you could unmute and come in, sir.
Yes, thank you. Good evening. Reverend Barrow, let me thank you for the way you presented the topic, shedding light on this concept and practice of self. Now, you made the point that church busyness causes us to neglect time to be alone with God. Sister Jan also pointed to the how our own personal busyness can get in the way. Now, What would you say are some of the other principal problems that prevent us from developing that intimate relationship with God? And apart from the point you made about being, about finding time to linger with God, with scripture being at the center of the conversation, and finding self in our personal business, what are some of the other ways that we can practice and experience self and so that we can deepen our relationship with Christ and experience personal transformation of our lives?
Very, very good questions, or at least the way in which you put it in sort of, you know, in that context in which you put it. Here's what I know, friends. And I know sometimes, let me start with my own personal experience in terms of what I see and what I myself sometimes get caught in. I know that there are folks who only rely on Sunday morning worship and a 20-minute sermon, or perhaps it might go for 30 minutes, to be the only substance they get from Sunday to the next Sunday. And if they're not coming every Sunday, from Sunday to whenever they come next. And there's a sense that I believe that in some ways we have emphasized worship over and against what happens before and after worship. I have a sense in which I know I have developed as a pastor, and I'm not doing this as a pastor, because one of the things I did for a long time was I only read the scripture when I had to prepare a sermon. This habit of reading a chapter a day is not to prepare a sermon. And I think folks have to, one of the things we have in, I know we have it in the MCCA, we have it in the UMC, is that we have set lectionary readings that if during the course of Monday to Saturday, you are reading through the Old Testament, the Gospels, the Epistle, or the Epistle, the Gospels, even you'll be surprised, that's about half of the Bible, just reading through from Monday to Saturday, the readings to prepare for Sunday. I believe that would be one example I would give, that folks, that most of us have it either printed in the bulletin, the worship bulletin for this week, for the week to come. It is accessible. We put that actually, that information on our weekly update. So I think there's a sense in which what I am asking for is for folks not to, to take accountability for what it means, leaders and members, for not relying solely on the worship experience. That is important. That is part of why we are, we come together for fellowship. But beyond that and before that, I think we need to be able to have that personal time, that cell time. And if every day you were committed to reading just a fraction of those lectionary readings, I believe it will go a long way for you to discover some of the very things that you weren't thinking of before. So Brother Lawrence, that's one for sure. I really wasn't trying to joke about what we do in meetings, but I think sometimes even in meetings, I would like to see those who are leading meetings to pause within meetings for a moment of deep silence. It doesn't hurt for us when all the voices have been going in a meeting. Just keep going. Just for someone to call for a moment of silent prayers, not blank silent prayers, but prayers around the very things we are talking about. I also want to see us allow children and young people to be creative about just spending they're intentional time with God. I think one of the things we don't do well enough is even in their Sunday school or in their youth group to start practicing these disciplines, these spaces. This is not an age requirement for sacred spaces. There's no age requirement. It's from 0 to 99. And I have a sense that we have to allow young people to do that. I also would hope, as another place, is that we are asking folks after worship or before worship to be spending time praying for God to reveal things for us in worship and praying for what God would have us do following worship. I would really love to see a pattern for my life and for the life of my worshipers, my congregational congregants, to be able to say, Lord, what it is you're going to provide for me and for us in this space? What are you going to provide through the instrument of the voice you have given to us this morning? And what, Lord, are you preparing us to do this week? I think those are patterns that we could develop. And I have tried to do it. And sometimes I think what we do is we wait for Lent to do it, or we wait for revival services to do it. And I think this has to be something over time. And by the way, you don't have to do it all in a big chunk. You know, it could be this simple 1 minute, 30 seconds, 5 minute spells. I don't think you need to be constantly spending hours of the days doing this. So, Brother Lawrence, I hope that's helpful.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, thank you, Brother Lawrence. Okay, so we have, I'll have a comment in the chat and a question, and then we'll come to Sister Harper, Sister Shirley. So in the chat, we just have a comment here. In addition to cell time with God, I encourage us to maintain a Sabbath day as prescribed in scripture. That's coming from Brother Kenneth Williams. And then Sister Aduni, I think is the pronunciation. Thanks for this. It makes me think of the concept of having the heart of Mary, sister of Martha, facilitated by finding a physical space that helps us to reclaim the themes of the Sabbath in our everyday lives, resting in Christ, reading, hearing, and meditating on his word, opening ourselves to listen to him so our hearts and souls remain centered on God. Okay, so I'm going to invite Sister Shirley to come in, and you can unmute.
Yes, good night. I'm listening intently to the cell, and I'm enjoying what I'm hearing and going along with quite a bit of it. But suppose you are in your cell, and you can't get your mind to settle down. You want to read the Bible, your mind racing and going all over the place. You want to pray and hear God talking to you, your mind racing and going all over the place. Is that a failed attempt at being in a cell relationship with God? Or how do you deal with that?
Thank you, Sister Shirley. I think sometimes we make it about us rather than making it about God. It is not about us. And sometimes I think one of the things I say is when we go into cell, you take your hymn book or your voices in praise, or you take material that you can allow your mind to set on those things. I don't think you have to be too preoccupied with whether God is with you or God is hearing you or God is speaking with you. I think sometimes we need to just allow the moment to be what the moment is. Mm-hmm. So that even if your mind is racing, as you say, and that happens to all of us, we sort of sometimes go off course, right? And it happens in prayer time, but I think sometimes we only use the conversational element in prayer. We don't use just being silent, even if your mind is racing. Or sometimes what you do is you take one word or one thought or one word from the scripture and just try to focusing on what loves mean or what patience mean or what gentleness mean or what stewardship means, and you just try to focusing on that one word in sort of deep thought. And I think sometimes those kinds of exercises, of course, they over time, you develop a clearer sense of less distraction, whether you think your mind is racing. But here's what, I wouldn't feel completely guilty if your mind is racing, because it's still not about us. It's about God. And
I was just wondering if you will see it as a failed attempt to be in cell with God, because you couldn't keep your thoughts there and that kind of thing. But
when that happens, I think you pause. You know, I doubt it's happening every single second. You know, so I think you pause. And I think, you know, we have some rich, you know, one of the things Jesus did is as he listened to his, we have one story of Jesus listening to his mother singing, right? A Magnificat, right? But Jesus often listened to his mother singing. And I think singing, whether you're singing out aloud or you're reading the words from hymns and songs, it will bring you back, would bring you back to centering, right? So, I think it's important for you to keep in mind that the resources at your disposal, with the Bible being the main source, would bring you back, would bring you to that place of centering again.
I like the idea, though, of a word or something like that, because sometimes the Bible might be there, you start to read and your brain gone.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So maybe a word or something just singular might be more effective than trying to pull back your mind, so to speak.
And sometimes people have symbols. They may have a lit candle, or they may have some other symbol that they could focus on and try to understand, what does this light mean? What does this particular, what does the cross mean? They may have different things, other symbols to bring them to a place of deeper concentration and connection.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sister Shirley.
Thank you, Sister Shirley, and good to see you. So I was just contemplating actually a couple of the things that came up during the conversation. And one of them that struck me, you've used the word intentional quite heavily, right? Quite heavily. And that obviously struck to me that the intentional nature of the discipline is something that we can't lose sight of. So some of the things that you've mentioned in terms of how to bring your mind back, how to bring your understanding back to where you're actually placing your attention. There are two things that come to mind, and unfortunately they're both kind of interrelated. One is Dallas Willard. He tends to, he used to always speak about ruthlessly eliminating hurry from your life. We did a Bible study, I think a few years back, actually it might have been 2020, if I remember correctly. And he was a proponent of that, ruthlessly eliminating hurry from your life.
Yes.
Persons who know me may say that maybe I need to do less hurrying and more time. You mentioned about being on time, but that's something I struggle with. I'm working on it. And then another thing that I've heard, and I've used it before and told our youth as well, is that true worship only happens when our heart's attention, our mind's attention and our heart's affection are focused on God and for who he is and what he's done. So I believe that focus that you spoke of, that intentionality, is extremely important, because in our time, we tend to move with all of the things that we've got, the social media, the television, all of these things are training our brains to not be able to come to that point of focus. And I guess, as you said, maybe candles, a point of the hymn book versus using, you know, YouTube and those kind of things, where a hymn book kind of brings you back to basics, right?
Yeah,
and absolutely. You don't have to be scrolling and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. I want to add something to that. The intent, why I'm using the word intentional, the intentional discipleship is not something I invented. Intentional is in the DNA of people called Methodists. Let's listen to the word Methodist. We are methodical people, right? In this way, when Charles and John found themselves at Oxford and decided to meet together, here's the intentionality. We would get up early in the morning, we would pray, we would read scripture, we would sing, we would pray. And every day they either find the orphan, or they find widows, or they go to the prison, or they find people on the street. Every day, the Holy Club was about intentional discipleship, intentional faith growth, or faith, mm-hmm. intentional faith journey. And I think if we kind of recapture that again, that intentionality that we saw in the Wesleyan way of doing things, we would once again see that that is the word that would help us in our own private, personal, spiritual journey to be intentional about our prayer time, to be intentional about silence, to be intentional about what happens before worship, during worship, after worship. I think after a while we could develop some discipline about it. And the word discipline, by the way, is not a bad word, right? Spiritual discipline. Richard Foster was the one who wrote the book on spiritual disciplines. And The Celebration of Disciplines was the name of the book. So I like how you sort of bring that together there.
Okay. I'm just scanning all of the time just to see if we had any other persons wanting to come in to ask a question of you or to have a comment. I would have seen. Okay, here it is. We do have a question, I think, from, I believe, Sister Odoni again. Would you say that this intentionality is about covenanting with Christ?
Yeah, so that word covenanting with Christ, and of course, you know, I'm not sure how the word covenanting is being used there, but once again, if I were to go to the Wesley Covenant Prayer, which would be something, you know, we can grab and say, a lot of us could recite it, but first, for example, if I did draw a quick illustration of that covenant prayer is about promise. It's about a purpose behind it. It is about what God is going to do with us and what we would do with God and with others, right? So covenanting is a word, if I understand the word it's being used, but covenanting is an interesting word, though, but I don't sure if she's using that in the context of
James.
I was just hearing. I wasn't sure. James, trying to
now you mean?
Continue for us. You're trying to keep an eye on it.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
I think covenant with God, but I don't, you know, God is coming to us before we are coming to God. And in the midst of God coming to us, God, you know, seeking us, we form a covenant with God. So we form a covenant with God. We form a covenant with each other, and we form a covenant to also reach others. So I when I hear the word covenant sometimes, I'm not sure covenanting with God, perhaps like someone could say more about it, but I'm not sure I am necessarily capturing that well.
Yeah, I did reach out to ask if we could get maybe just a little more. Okay. The comment comes back. He is explaining it just as I thought about it. Thanks. Okay. So you have hit the mark there on that one for sure. So I don't know if we have any others who would want to comment or ask a question. I think as we've come through the last 3 weeks, the intent of the author has been becoming more and more succinct in terms of yes. understanding yourself as well, because I found that
yes.
if taking it to the point of being quiet, not just quiet, but in a period of time where it is you, your thoughts, right. and God, right? Yes. There's nowhere to hide. Not that there ever is, but in a yeah. case like that, it is easy for busyness to come in and those types of things and take yeah. you away from that point. But once you're in that space of being alone with God, it is just you, your thoughts, and Him. And it's probably the best time, as you said. I guess that's the place where you're repenting of sin. You're praising God. You are coming to a point of a period of quietness where you actually do actually listen and maybe just experience peace being in His presence.
Ling said it's a place of honesty and puzzle, because as you said, it's just you and God, mm-hmm. the resources you have, right? But it's a place of honesty. If it's the one place you can be honest, is in that place. Maybe the other thing I kind of gloss over is that I think sometimes cell could invite someone at times, a companion, because Jesus had alone time with God, but Jesus also invited His disciples yeah. to have time with Him. So I just thought about that, because when I hear the word covenant, you could covenant with someone. There are covenant groups in which people covenant with someone to be present at certain times in their spiritual journey. But I think Links is not necessarily going there. I'm just saying, I think there are times when you could have someone with you that you covenant to do something that is going to, you know, help both of you grow in your faith journey. But that sense that when you are alone, a lot is exposed. The nakedness of yourself before God can happen. And you can be as open as you want to be with God. You should be.
Yes, I do agree entirely. I would mention, just as we probably are coming to a close, unless we're going to get some more questions coming in. Oops, there we go. We have a raised hand from Sister Michelle Campbell Allen. I would ask you to come in. You can unmute.
Hi, good evening.
Hello, Michelle. Oh,
hi. So we know we have persons at different stages in their Christian walk.
Absolutely.
So for someone who may be a babe in the walk, how would they know that if they are starting off in their alone time with God, how would they know that this conversation that's going on is, you know, them and God, as opposed to them and them, they're trying to, and it's not their thoughts that they're willing into, that they're thinking it's God. How would you know? How would this person know, especially someone who is a babe in the whole process?
Well, I think that might be related to what Sister Shirley was asking. And here's what I know. You got to take baby steps, because as Ling says, you hold the key. You have to go at your pace. You have to not focus so much on what, I think sometimes we focus too much on ourselves and not allow the moment to be what it is. And I think For those who are just starting off, I think less is more. I think you have to be willing to start in the simplest of ways. It might just be a minute. It might just be, the time doesn't really matter. But I think to not be discouraged, to not feel like this is overwhelming, because it can feel overwhelming. Silence itself can be overwhelming, right? But I think developing patterns like that, and by the way, I think sometimes people could I think you don't move directly to sell without first having someone else or a group of folks with you. So one of the things I don't want us to forget here is that sell overlaps and is related to other aspects that include being with others, right? And I think sometimes you learn habits, spiritual habits, from those who are more mature in the faith. And therefore, I think the way to start is to align yourself with one or two, perhaps two other people, maybe one other person who you are patterning, not just by spending time with them, but maybe there are things they would, by watching them. I think you have to do that first before you could get to the stage where you are comfortable being alone. So that's how we have interrelatedness of the sacred space. And even though cell would be the alone time with God, it may be for others, starting with another sacred space would make cell more fruitful when they get to that. It doesn't mean that you don't spend any time alone, you know. It just means that you take baby steps there while you learn from other sacred spaces that will strengthen your cell time with God. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. I have a comment here in the chat from, or question actually, from Sister Margaret Gill. Isn't there space in all of this for fun and play with God?
Well, I consider myself someone who, you know, like to spend, you know, I'm a person, I do a lot of social stuff, right? So yes, the answer is yes. Holy play would be a good way to put it, right? Holy play. I think part of it is this, friends. And I've said this to a friend of mine recently. I think we take ourselves too seriously. We need to take the word of God seriously, and we take ourselves too seriously. So if the person is asking what I think is a question about if all of this is sort of like, you know, a prison cell, is this all, is this hard work? I would say again that we have to just relax. We have to, we can find sell in the fact that in the Caribbean, we can go for a walk, we can go hiking, we can go to the beach. We could find alone time beyond a private altar place we have developed in our home. So my answer is yes. There is this sense of joy. Joy comes from it. Fulfillment comes from it. And I think it's different for different people, right? But I would not say that it is outside of it. I think it's in it. And I think we individually, based on our personalities, have to find ways to include it because we're different. So we have to find ways to include it. And I find lots of joy in all the things I do. When I'm a percussionist, as you heard, and when I am drumming, as part of my alone time with God, I find that I get joy in that. But there are other ways in which you can find joy, and that would be based on other people's personalities.
Yes, I can think for myself that I discovered walking by necessity during the pandemic, and I found that walking and praying and listening or singing at the time and that kind of thing was helpful as well.
And I wonder if the question was also based around too, mm-hmm. that sometimes people are not finding social, let's call it not playtime, but social. People are not doing, we're just doing what appears to be work that doesn't allow for laughter and for joy. And there's the idea that we could do social things and be comfortable with that. Because look, I tell you something, in my church here, they know that I'm ready for the next party. I'm ready for the next fun time. Not because it's all about fun and games, but I think sometimes we do make church look like, I hope it's not in the South Caribbean, where we can have some fun. I'm sure there's fun happening there. But I think every time we, you know, for everything that we do, there's always another opportunity to center us in God, right? So, I mean, that's, I wanted to add that.
No problem. I agree. We have here Sister Jean, Sister Jeanne, and then Sister Margaret. So Sister Jeanne, if you could come in.
Sure. I think maybe one of the things Sister Margaret might have been thinking is, what about God with his sense of humor?
Yes.
I think the more we engage God, you know, like he's there with you. You know, you heard a good joke, you know, you share it with him. You chuckle together. I've had God tell me some things that, you know, clearly he was ribbing me and giving me a little hard time. But he has a sense of humor. He does. And
absolutely.
He appreciates our humor. He appreciates our joy. He appreciates our sharing. So I tend to be a more serious person. So I'll be the one who does more serious stuff. And he'll create the light moments. But there are some people who is the other way around. It's as you engage God and as you hear his responses that you recognize, oh, okay. It's not all that serious, or it's not all that in a box, you know? God is way beyond outside of the box that we have put him in.
Right. Yeah. You said it well, and I appreciated that. Appreciate that, Jeanne. That's just right. I think that puts more to what I think the question was about. And thank you for that.
Welcome.
Hi, Sister Margaret.
Yes.
Yes, please.
Because are you hearing me? Yes. Because John is in theology class with me, and John is exposed to my foolishness. John understood what I was trying, because I was talking about not social with other people. I was talking about with God. And I'll just give you one small instance. The other day I was praying, talking to God, and I was saying, you know, God, I was a better Christian. I didn't make so much mistakes and things, you know, and I said, but I promise I can do better in the future. And I heard, or I felt in me, a promise, a promise is a comfort for a fool. I am foolish. I promise God that I would do better. And I heard God say to me, a promise is a comfort for a fool. I am foolish. Meaning, I know you ain't going to do that. You're going to go down the road and you're going to do the next stupid thing. And I can be there saying to myself, you see, she? That's the fun I'm talking about.
And I think God, if we could admit, I think if we were honest with ourselves, Margaret, we all have been there. And
one of the reasons I asked that question is because about the fun and play is because I was getting worried about the big words like intentionality and covenant. And the Bible say you have to be like a little child. A friend sent me a photograph of her granddaughter today, and the child has her two hands, she's two, her two hands behind her back, and she's holding over her mother's large vase with flowers, and she's smelling it. Mm. And I was thinking, and it's like she's doing it like a bow. She's two, and she's holding over to smell the flowers. that her mom has on a table. And I'm thinking that, you know, you understand, you all understand what I mean, that God is a big, big, big baby. God is a baby. And God speaks to the baby in our heart. And this cell, well, I didn't get the meaning of that word because I came in at 8 or something. But if it means like this, the priest's cell, the time with God is not in the cell, it's in an open place. It could be in the cell too, but I'm thinking that the cell is not a small place. The cell is the whole. My son used to teach the guitar lessons to prisoners. And he come back and he tell me he was going to community college at the time. And he came back and he told me, you know, mommy, when I'm teaching those guys guitar lessons, they're not in prison. For the 2 hours that we are learning, I'm teaching them and they're learning how to play the guitar. They're not in prison. So the cell is not as, the cell is like the stable. The cell is a big place. It's a huge place where you bow to smell the flowers and you talk to God foolish and God is a promise, is a comfort, a fool, and I am foolish. I'm gone.
Margaret Lings would say that the cell is wherever it is. So I don't think there is any sort of limitation to where cell is. So in that sense, if cell is wherever it is, I think that kind of answers the question right there about cell, right? We put limitations. God doesn't put limitations. And but I appreciate, you know, you've given us some food for thought in what you shared. And I agree with, you know, with everything that you shared there.
Okay. I'm just checking this one more time to make sure that we don't have any other questions. We do have one. I think this possibly will be our last, I think, from the looks of it. So I'm going to ask Sister Shirley to come back in.
It's just a comment that I want to say that sometimes you can think of a cell as being an instantaneous moment. Then maybe in something you just turn to God and ask a question. And just to show what I mean, when I was working, I remember I was heading home and ran into a roadblock because of an accident. And I said, Lord, I have to turn back. So what road do I take? And I heard very clearly I was to retrace my steps to a place named Bennett. I go down and come down into Old Town and go home. But when I turned back and I got by St. Thomas Church, I saw nothing coming up, so I went down that hill. And it is though God laughed at me at some point, because when I went down that hill, there was a worse roadblock because there was an accident at the bottom of that hill. So then I had to turn around and go all the way to the point he told me, and go down Bennett, and go down into Whole Town from there, and go home. So, and I could feel in my spirit as though God was laughing at me then. He said that I told you, but you did it yourself. So, I mean, it can be instantaneous like that, you know? So, yeah. I like the idea of coming out of this box, that it has to be, it could be anywhere. And I agree with that wholeheartedly. And instantaneous, not even a long drawn out session.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Sister Shirley, and also Sister Margaret. So what I'm going to do, I have a bit of text here, very short text I'm going to read for us. It's a version of the 23rd Psalm. And it's a translation done from Japan, and kind of fits well with what Reverend Barrow has been speaking about this evening. And as we kind of come to a close, and I don't see any further questions, and as I hand over to Brother Craig, the Lord is my pace setter is how they start. The Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. He makes me stop for quiet intervals. He provides me with images of stillness, which restore my serenity. He leads me in the way of efficiency through calmness of mind, and his guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish each day, I will not fret, for his presence is here. His timeliness, his all importance, will keep me in balance. He prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity by anointing my head with his oils of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Truly, harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruits of my hours, for I shall walk in the pace of my Lord and dwell in his house forever.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah.
So you as can we say everybody, and they can use statements from that.
Yes, I'll talk to Rev and make sure that we get it out. Definitely. So I guess it is thought provoking. You've sparked something here, I believe, Reverend Barrow, in terms of how persons view this time. And as Sister Margaret just also reiterated, it is not to be a time of humdrum and you know, being pressed into this box of what you think it may be as a cell. So I don't know if you have any further closing comments before we invite Brother Craig to close for us.
My appreciation, and to reconnect with actually some of the sisters and brothers who came on, people I know very well, and to express my appreciation. And I have been, this has been an inspiration to me as well to be a part of this. And I thank you for inviting me. So thank you.
Brother Craig, over to you.
Thank you very much, Brother Kelvin. Let me, of course, say thank you very much to our presenter this evening, Reverend Barrow. I think you've definitely given us food for thought as we would have explored the idea and the concept of cell and really what it means to connect with God, and the idea that cell doesn't have to be solitary confinement, but rather you can have individuals who are your partners, who are journeying with you, and they can keep you accountable. And as you are doing in your own Lenten exercise, where you are reading the book of John, I believe it is, with a very good friend of yours, as we have those moments, we can also lean on each other as we have our alone time with God, wherever that space may be, whether it be in a room, whether it be out in nature, that this opportunity to have that alone time with God and how vital it is, especially as we seek to deepen our faith. So thank you very much, Reverend Barrow, for sharing with us and for engaging with us and taking our questions and infusing all of this with levity and with insight. Thank you so very much.
Yes.
We also want to thank Brother Kelvin for ably hosting us this evening. And I definitely like the version of the 23rd Psalm that you shared as we ended our reflection on self. And it really is one that reminds us to come away from the busyness of life and to connect with God. Thank you very much, Brother Kelvin. We also want to say thank you to Reverend Phils, who led us in our devotions and really set the pace for this evening. We also want to thank our tech team, all of those who were part of the planning committee, all of those who ensured that we had the opportunity to fellowship here this evening. And of course, to every single person that joined in this discussion. I know that we had persons from Trinidad, especially South Trinidad, who were on. I know we have persons from Antigua, persons from Jamaica, persons from the US, persons from the UK, persons from all over who have been journeying with us over these last couple of weeks as we spend a few moments thinking about the seven sacred spaces. And they have religiously joined us and continue to join us each and every single week. And we thank you for that. For those persons who this may be your first time joining us, we want to invite you to come again next week as well and be part of that group of persons who are fellowshipping together and learning together as we explore the seven sacred spaces. Next week, we are going to reconvene next week, Wednesday, at 6:30 p.m. And that, of course, is going to be, I believe, the clocks in the U.S. You can correct me if I'm wrong, Reverend Barrow, but I do believe the clocks, Eastern Standard Time, they're going to drop back this weekend. So you should be on the same time.
That is correct.
And of course, those of us in the Caribbean, save and except for those in Jamaica who are 1 hour behind us, we are going to be reconvening at 6:30 p.m. And we're going to have next week Reverend Dr. Gordon Edwards. And we're going to be looking at the topic of chapter house, making decisions. And we all know that in life, we do have to make decisions. I mean, each and every single day, we have to make decisions. How do you go about that process of making decisions? And how do you do that in a way and where you involve God in that process? So we're going to be looking at that next week. And hopefully you're able to join us. And of course, I recognize Sister Sheila, who is in Panama. Thank you very much for joining us. I will look forward to seeing you next week. So as we bring our session to a close, let me invite our superintendent minister, who is also the bishop of the South Caribbean District of the Methodist Church in the Caribbean and the Americas, Reverend Derek Richards, to close us off in prayer and also to give the benediction.
Thank you very much, Craig, and thank you for what you have been doing over these weeks of these deeper life encounters, of helping us to make the connection with the weeks prior and setting up the week that is to come. Thank you so much for a tremendous job in that regard. And also just want to say thanks to my good friend and colleague, Reverend Barrow, for again gracing us with his presence and sharing so well with us. Let us pray. God, our God, we acknowledge that our world is constantly on the move. Life is constantly beckoning us to move to the next event, the next situation, the next chapter. And we find ourselves constantly on the go. Even within the context of the church, we are constantly being asked to move from one activity to another, from one meeting to another, from one mission project to another, from one service to another. God, if we are not careful, we would not only end up being tired, but our greater fear is to become weary. And we acknowledge that there are many of your servants, your children, who have become weary, who have lost the zeal for you and for fellowship with you. Persons who have become weary and feel a deep sense of emptiness, hollowness, and a superficial connection with the divine. And we thank you, God, for this series of the seven sacred spaces where we are learning how to integrate life, the various spaces, and to maintain our balance and to sustain our one life. We are learning how to remove the dichotomy that we've created between secular and sacred, and to see everything as sacred, and to see all of life as being lived in relation with God and with those who accompany us on life at the various stages and places. Tonight, we give you thanks for the reflections on self, on being alone with God, entering into deep prayer and reflection. And we lift up the words of the psalmist, as the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after God. For God alone is my heart's desire. And oh, how I long to be in his presence. How I long to be wrapped in his arms. How I long to feel God's warm embrace. So teach us, O God, how to come apart, lest we come apart. Teach us how to draw nearer and nearer to you each day and each moment. We give you thanks, O Reverend Barrow, and for the ways in which he has inspired us and has shared with us and has enabled our reflection, our introspection, and our commitments. Now, as a part of God, we pray that you'd now help us to find how we can live out our faith in the various spaces that we have already reflected on, while we prepare to discover more how we can further our walk with you and our relationships with others in this world, all to the glory and honor of your name. And so, my brothers and sisters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace now and forevermore. And the people of God say, Amen and Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you all, and do have a pleasant night. And please join us again next Wednesday as we continue on this journey. God bless you all.
Bless you too.
Bless you too.
Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too.
Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless you too. Bless